वेलकम बैक स्टूडेंट्स. नाउ वी विल स्टार्ट अवर चैप्टर 5th, स्टेट्स ऑफ मैटर. इन दिस चैप्टर वी विल स्टडी हाउ द बल्क प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ मटीरियल अराइजेस फ्रॉम द बिहेवियर ऑफ इंडिविजुअल पार्टिकल्स, एटम्स, आयंस और मॉलिक्यूल्स. वी शैल ऑल्सो लर्न मोर अबाउट द डिफरेंट फिजिकल स्टेट्स ऑफ मैटर, पर्टिकुलरली गैसेज एंड लिक्विड स्टेट्स. वी नो दैट देर आर 3 स्टेट्स ऑफ मैटर, namely solid, liquid and gaseous state. The important characteristics of 3 states are that solid states have definite size and definite shape, whereas the liquid state has a definite volume but do not have a definite shape. A gaseous state has neither a definite volume nor a definite shape. But how will you classify a solid? A substance is said to be solid if its melting point is above room temperature under atmospheric conditions. A substance is liquid if its melting point is below room temperature and boiling point is above room temperature. And any substance is gas if its boiling point is below room temperature under atmospheric condition. It may be noted that a given substance may also exist simultaneously in all the 3 states under certain specific condition of temperature and pressure. That condition is known as triple point. The temperature at which all the 3 phases of the same substance exist simultaneously is known as triple point. For example, water exists in all the 3 phases simultaneously, that is your solid, liquid and gas, at 0.01 degrees Celsius and 4.58 mm of Hg pressure. We know that all the matter is made up of particles and there must be the intermolecular forces of attraction between the particles. The forces of attraction or repulsion between the particles are known as intermolecular forces, and there are different types of intermolecular forces between the particles. They may be your dispersion force or the London force. In dispersion and London force, atoms and non-polar molecules are electrically symmetrical and have no dipole moment because their electronic charge cloud is symmetrically distributed. But the intermolecular forces may exist even in these non-polar atoms, such as noble gases or non-polar molecules such as your O2, N2, H2, etc. This is because the noble gases and non-polar molecule can be liquefied, suggesting that there must be some intermolecular force of attraction. We may say a dipole may develop momently even in such atoms or molecules. So for these atoms or molecules, we are having atom A, which is symmetrically distributed. Atom B is there, which is also symmetrically distributed, having electron charge cloud. Atom A have an instantaneous dipole moment which start developing a force of attraction to atom B, and therefore it has induced a dipole there. These forces are very weak and the strength of the force depend upon the size of the molecule, number of electrons present in the molecules and molecular structure. For example, large molecules have much diffuse charge cloud, hence there are greater chance of it distortion and produce instantaneous dipoles. Therefore, the strength of van der Waals forces increases with molecular size. The larger the number of electrons in the molecules, the greater the chance of distortion of electron cloud. For example, the boiling point of monoatomic noble gas increases from helium to radium. The shape of the molecules also has a significant effect on the magnitude of London forces. For example, N-pentane, isopentane and neopentane have the same molecular formula C5H12. However, their boiling point are different. The boiling point of N-pentane is about 27 degrees higher than that of neopentane. So this is about the molecular structure. Next comes the force of attraction is dipole-dipole forces. These 4 type of forces occur in molecules which have permanent electric dipoles, such as HCl, H2O, NH3, etc. A polar molecule has separate centers of positive and negative charges, and the end of the dipole process partial positive or partial negative charges. The partial positive charges attracts the oppositely charged particle from the next atom or the molecule. These interactions are stronger than the London forces. However, these are weaker than ion-ion interaction because only partial charge are involved. The interaction decreases with the increase of distance between the dipole. As in London forces, the interaction in energy is inversely proportional to the distance between the polar molecule. Dipole-dipole interaction energy between stationary polar molecule is proportional to 1 by R3, R cube, and that's between rotational polar molecule is proportional to 1 by R6, where R is the distance between the polar molecule. The dipole-dipole interaction in a molecule of the solid has positive A positive and B negative, which interact with each other having the dipole-dipole forces. Next one is our dipole-induced dipole forces. In this case, one of the molecule is having a permanent dipole molecule and it introduces a non-permanent dipole moment into a non-polar molecule. So a dipole has been induced in a non-polar dipole molecule, therefore it is known as polar induced dipole moment, yeah, forces. The easier the molecules are deformed, the greater are the force of attraction. The effect was studied by Debye in 1920 and is known as induced effect. Next one is our hydrogen bond. When hydrogen atom is bonded to atoms of highly electronegative elements like fluorine, oxygen, nitrogen, etc., the hydrogen atom forms a weak bond with the electronegative atom of the other molecule. This bond is called hydrogen bond. However, hydrogen bond is stronger than that of your London forces or your dipole-dipole interaction or dipole-induced dipole interaction. The hydrogen molecule bonds is present in our water molecules, and molecule also exert repulsion forces on another molecules. When two molecules are brought in close contact with each other, the repulsion forces may also start operating. These are between the electron cloud and between the nucleus of the two molecules. The magnitude of repulsion force increases rapidly as the distance between the molecules decreases. This is the reason that liquids and solid are hard to compress. In liquid and solid, the molecules are already close and therefore they result resist further compression because that would result in the increase of repulsion interaction. So not only the interaction forces are there, but there are also repulsion forces between the molecules. The force of attraction or the force of repulsion depends upon the thermal energy. That energy is of a body due to the motion or the movement of its atoms or molecule is known as thermal energy. And thermal energy is more in your gases than in liquid and than in solid. So the movement of the particles are more in gases than in liquid and than in solid. And second one is your intermolecular interaction. Yeah, intermolecular interaction energy. So here, whether which state will be there of the matter depends upon two things. First one is your thermal energy and second one is your interaction energy. Interaction energy is maximum in solid and minimum in gases. Now there is the types of bonding and the melting and boiling points. If the intermolecular force of attraction between the particles are strong, the melting and boiling points become high, whereas if the intermolecular forces are weak, melting and boiling points become weak. The polar molecule generally have higher molecular boiling point than non-polar molecules because there is a force of attraction between the particles. Melting point and boiling point of ionic compound will be higher due to the strong, again, force of attraction between the ions. Now we will start the gaseous state of matter. There are some measurable properties of the gases. We can measure the mass, volume, pressure of the gas. So How to measure these properties of a gas will be explained here. Mass. What is mass? It is the amount of gas. So how we can measure the mass by the formula: weight of the container containing the mass subtract the weight of the container after removing the gas. Here we will get the mass of the gas present in that container. The unit of the mass is kg, and we can find number of moles also from it by the mass in grams upon the molar mass of that gas. Secondly, volume. The volume of the substance is the space occupied by it, and therefore the volume of a gas is same as the volume of the container, and its unit is your liters. Pressure. It is a force per unit area, therefore the pressure of the gas is the force exerted by the gas of the atmosphere on the surface of the earth is known as atmospheric pressure. And atmospheric pressure is measured by the mercury barometer. Mercury is used as a liquid in a liquid barometer because the height of the column in a barometer is inversely proportional to the density of the liquid. It can be explained here. Since mercury is very dense, it is the best for the barometer as it supposed column of the convenient height. Here I have taken the mercury barometer. Mercury has been filled, inverted tube has been inverted, glass tube is closed at one end and filling it with a pure mercury. The tube is then carefully inverted into an open vessel of mercury. The mercury level in the tube drops until the pressure due to the column of the mercury in the tube becomes equal to the atmospheric pressure acting outside the tube. This is the reason that whole of the mercury does not run out. The reason about the mercury in the tube is almost perfect vacuum. Therefore, the pressure due to mercury column is equal to that of the atmospheric pressure, and the height of the mercury column in a inverted tube will tell you the amount of atmospheric pressure, and it is at 0 degrees Celsius. It is about 760 mm or 760 mmHg. Now, the pressure can be measured in two ways. First one is by the open end manometer, and the second one is by the closed end manometer. Here is the diagram given by for the open end manometer. It consists of a U-tube shaped tube with one limb shorter than the other. It is partially filled with mercury. The shorter limb is connected to the vessel containing the gas, whereas the longer limb is open to the atmosphere. The mercury in the longer limb is subjected to the atmospheric pressure, while the mercury in the shorter limb is subjected to the pressure of the gas. The difference in the level of the mercury in the two limbs gives the difference of the pressure on the two sides, that is, atmospheric pressure minus gaseous pressure is equal to the difference in the mercury level in the two columns. Therefore, the pressure of the gas will be the pressure, atmospheric pressure minus the height, which is the difference between the height of the mercury between two limbs. If we are having the closed end manometer, in this we have taken a U-shaped tube with one limb shorter than the other. It is partially filled with mercury. The shorter end limb is to be connected to the vessel connecting the gas, whose pressure is to be determined, whereas the longer limb is closed. The shape above the mercury of the closed end side is completely evacuated. The gas will exert a force on the mercury and thereby force the level down in the near side and up in the far side of the manometer. This gives rise to a difference in the mercury level in the two limbs, which is equal to the pressure of the gas. Therefore, in this case, the pressure of the gas is equal to the difference in the mercury level in the two limbs, that is equal to its height. Now there comes the temperature. Temperature is the measurement of hotness or coldness of the body. We can calculate the temperature in the three scales, that is degree Celsius, Kelvin scale, as well as Fahrenheit scale. So here are some relation between the degree Celsius and Kelvin scale. Kelvin is equal to degree Celsius plus 273.15, and degree Celsius will be equal to F by 9 degree Fahrenheit minus 32. We have to solve the numericals over here. Now, to explain the gases, we are having certain laws, and the generalization of these laws are known as gas laws. How the volume of a gas depend upon the amount of gas, pressure and temperature will be shown by these gases law. In this case, we have the first law that is known as Boyle's law, and this gives us the relation between pressure volume. So here, in this case, we have trapped the relation between the pressure and volume, and it states that at constant temperature, pressure of a fixed amount of gas varies inversely with the volume of the gas. So P is directly proportional to 1 by V at constant temperature, and the amount of gas also should have to be remain constant. And we have got another formula for this, is that P V is equal to KI, and that is your constant. And so P1 V1 is equal to P2 V2. If we draw a graph between pressure and volume, we see that as we increases the volume, pressure decreases, goes on decreasing. But at temperature, higher the temperature, higher will be your pressure. Okay, if we plot a graph between P and V, 1 by V, we find that at higher temperature, pressure will be more for the same amount of volume of the gas. The PV remains the same, remain constant even if we change the pressure. This graph are known as isotherm because it has been placed at constant temperatures. The second law is our Charles law. The Charles law states the relation between volume and temperature, and according to this Charles law, the pressure remaining constant, the volume of a fixed mass of a gas is directly proportional to the absolute temperature, that is V is directly proportional to T. So by removing the proportionality sign, we are having a constant K, and we call it as K2. Here V is directly proportional to K2I, and we have the formula VI upon TI equal to V2 upon T2, and we can see it with the graph that V is directly proportional to, as the temperature is increasing, volume of the gas is also increasing, because as the pressure has been kept constant, these graphs are known as isobars. Next law is our Gay-Lussac's law, which gives us the relation between pressure temperature. At constant volume, pressure of a fixed amount of gas varies directly with the temperature. So here, as we increases the temperature, pressure also increases. So P is directly proportional to T. And these graphs are known as isochoric because we have kept the constant volume here. Next law is Avogadro's law, volume amount relation. At a given temperature and pressure, the volume of a gas is directly proportional to the amount of gas. So V is directly proportional to N, where N is the amount of the substance, and we have kept the pressure and temperature constant here. So all gases containing equal amount of substance occupies the same volume at the same temperature and pressure. If we combine that these gases law, or we can have to find the ideal gas equation. So according to the Boyle's law, V is directly proportional to 1 by P. According to Charles' law, V is directly proportional to T. According to Avogadro's law, V is directly proportional to N, and on combining these law, we get V is directly proportional to NT upon P. And to remove the proportionality sign, we are having PV is equal to RNT, where R is the molar gas constant, and we get PV is equal to NRT. If N is 1, PV is equal to RT, and this is your ideal gas equation. What is the nature of R? R is equal to PV upon NT, P is equal to pressure, V is equal to volume, N is equal to moles, and T is the temperature. We know that pressure is equal to force upon area into volume upon moles into temperature. So force upon area is equal to length square, and volume is equal to length cube upon moles into temperature. On evaluating it, we got force into length upon moles into temperature, and we know that force into length is equal to work upon moles into temperature. Therefore, R represent work done per degree per mole, or energy per degree per mole. These are the different units of R at different units of volume and pressure. If we take the volume in liter and pressure in atmosphere, then the value of R will become 0.0821. If it is taken in your joules or per moles, then it will be your R equal to 8.314. We have to study all these units. We will do the numericals in the June session.